Science fiction is a genre founded upon ideas. Storytelling which embraces high concepts and imagination. Futuristic technologies, transportation, and even universes are all distinct possibilities in this narrative form, which in turn has provoked some of the most iconic and celebrated voyages in film history. Auteurs from all walks of life have dipped a toe into the infinite creative abyss that is science fiction, with varying degrees of success. Like with any film, novel, or fellow narrative source, the seemingly endless realm of the genre can occasionally be more of a curse than a gift. The bigger a story or an idea grows, the tougher it is to rein in. No matter how much time we spend with our heads tilted towards the stars, eventually we require a gravitational pull back down to Earth. This can be no crash landing either, rather an intricately orchestrated descent, and that takes a truly dexterous filmmaker. Enter Denis Villeneuve, the Canadian craftsman who is arguably the most consistent director at work today, and his latest film Arrival, a first attempt within the genre ahead of his much-anticipated Blade Runner sequel. Now, unlike the vast majority of modern Hollywood sci-fi, Villeneuve's feature maintains a remarkable focus upon character and drama, enabling the spectator's connection to his protagonists and narrative to elevate the otherworldly experiences. It is a rare work which harnesses a sense of tranquility and sensitivity, even when dealing with one of cinema's most fascinating and complex themes, extraterrestrial life. Over the course of this essay, we will highlight the ways in which Arrival connects and communicates with its audience, characters, and cinematic landscape by processing the many tonal, intellectual, and emotional shades it provides. To briefly recap the narrative before we delve deeper, Amy Adams stars as Dr. Louise Banks, a cultivated linguist who is appointed to lead an elite and covert unit following the unexplained landing of a mysterious spacecraft in Montana. A further 11 of these ships, named heptopods, have taken residency across the globe, daring humanity to unlock the secrets they possess. As mankind teeters on the verge of global warfare, Louise and her team, including Jeremy Renner's decorated mathematician Ian Donnelly and Forrest Whitaker's military leader Colonel Webber, embark in a race against time to uncover answers by attempting to communicate with the new inhabitants. At the very heart of Villeneuve's film is the idea of connection, about how we as a species interact and correspond with our fellow man, and indeed how we maintain relationships with our land. However, every individual person connects to another differently. We have no concrete or constructed method in order to achieve this. The only thing we all have in common as living, breathing organisms is time. It is the bookend of our existence. We are born, time passes, and we die. Arrival tackles our connection with time in an extremely profound and poignant manner. It is seen as both a healer and a destroyer, able to both make and break with equal precision. Louise resonates with her connections to time once she truly understands the power of the heptapod language. Their elaborate sentences and arrangement are far more than a visual method of interaction, rather a precursor for what's to come. Once you have fluency, you have clarity. The coordination of Louise's story throughout is fragmented, with her past, present, and future all culminating as one. We see flash-forwards projected as memories, and recollections as distinct reminders for what's forthcoming. At first, this narrative structure for our protagonist is somewhat disorientating, but as we, the viewer, form a deeper connection to her voyage, we render a clearer image too. This strategy isn't just conveyed in Louise's character growth, however. It also features heavily in her interaction with both Ian and the aliens. Throughout the film, Ian says phrases which act as triggers, be that emotional or spiritual, and they transport Louise to a place in her history, most of which we learn is ahead, not behind. Equally with the alien species, she enters a state of trance when pressing her hand against the glass wall which divides humanity and the intergalactic arrivals. Somehow the passing of connective current from both learning and appreciating each other enables her the chance to grow once the ordeal has concluded. Louise's connection to Ian's language, the tongue of their native land, is extremely different from her connection to the heptapod vocabulary, the tongue of future life, yet they are both vital to her character design. Equally, Arrival makes a clear indication of what connects us as a community. The scale of such a community is subjective, but the film paves ways for the largest senses, such as our planet, and the most intimate, such as Louise's family. Villeneuve's feature points to the idea of a single leader, that Earth has no primary ruler, and instead is separated into an array of rival civilizations. We all speak different languages, embrace different cultures, favor different laws, and construct different livelihoods in accordance with our location. However, as soon as Earth stops being the largest possible concept, the species upon it must unite in order to survive. The 12 countries which have heptapods in their perimeters have a choice: work alongside the fellow areas of the globe in order to solve the puzzle, or closely guard their findings and seize interaction. During the film, the latter is chosen, as countries such as China, Pakistan, and the United Kingdom are fearful that their intel could be used against them, words becoming weaponized. However, the presence of these spaceships is ultimately what brings the nations together. The aliens are a higher concept than Earth because largely, we upon Earth do not or cannot understand their way. We are designed to ascend to such a level of intellect and ability. The heptapods enable Earth, in all of its overtly complicated nature, to become a single, united community. Arrival details a key item or a figure as a binding method for communal behaviours too. For Louise, it is language. We share dialogue with others and receive dialogue in return. We share gestures with others and receive gestures in return. Her book, which Ian is reading when she is first taken from her home to the Montana site, states that language is the cornerstone of a civilization and is the first weapon drawn in a conflict. For Ian, however, it is Louise. Despite spending his entire career attempting to spill the secrets from the Pandora's box, which is science, he finds his sense of connection and fulfillment in her. Together, the pair are both connected by the heptapods and their daughter Hannah. Interestingly, her name is a palindrome, a term to describe a word or name which reads the same both forward and backwards. Her name is a reflective example of connection to not just her parents' past and future, but also to the shared language of humanity and alien, and how those resonate emotionally. The heptapods compose sentences in a circular fashion, as if they are written by both hands which meet in the middle. The middle of Louise and Ian is Hannah. Villeneuve's film is founded upon the power of communication. It details how important it is to not only solving problems, but equally strengthening relationships. To communicate is far more than to merely speak to another, rather engaging the languages of our design. Verbal, physical, mental. Louise's linguist is initially hired by Colonel Weber to translate a selection of animalistic wails and groans. These sounds provide no phrases, words, or point of reference. However, the sounds, when applied to the visuals, have a much deeper and ultimately emotional meaning. The heptapod inhabitants lack any noted facial features, meaning they cannot communicate with spoken word. Instead, they release a smog-like squid ink from their tentacles, which creates the decadent visual code of their kind. During the initial stages of arrival, the focus from Weber and the military is simple: find out why they are here and what are their intentions. Louise expertly points out in one of the finest sequences that there is far more to basic structural sentencing than we give credit for. She pens a line which asks Weber's core question before deconstructing terms to show how they can be misinterpreted and construed depending upon the situational usage. Before the heptapods can accurately communicate an answer, she needs to be sure that they understand what a question is. And before she can ask, "What are you doing here?" she needs to be sure that they understand "you" means a collective "you," as in all 12 heptapods, not just "you," the singular alien. Much like when teaching a young child, Louise and Ian adhere to their visual learning by using points of reference in order to provoke a response. Whiteboards are presented and animated exercises play out, all with the hope of landing an additional sentence from their language. Louise, the linguist, is tasked with understanding and reading the circular words they provide, but Louise, the human, is communicating with them on multiple levels. She and Ian decide to name their two heptapod aliens, Abbott and Costello, after the famous American comedy double act, which in turn strengthens their emotional palette with the arrivals. Communication in the film goes further than deciphering a foreign language, however. It is equally rooted in establishing relationships with core characters and indeed with us, the spectator. Ian, in particular, is a physical communicator. Throughout, he is seen to place a kind hand on a needing shoulder, or wrap a blanket around the cold and damp. He uses gestures in order to convey his emotional attachment, but also to deepen his experience. Despite never fully embracing the idea of a romance during the heptapod invasion, it is clear that Ian is attracted to Louise, and he is able to convey this without ever having to rely on words. Equally, Louise communicates with daughter Hannah through symbolic interaction. One minute she'll be listening in to alien recordings, the next transported to a period in her life with her child. She communicates with her inner and spiritual self, largely without awareness, but as the film ventures towards its ethereal and undeniably overwhelming climax, it becomes clear that she has subconsciously woven a rich tapestry. Arrival's worldwide narrative field also makes fine use of the international sites, with communication tools such as computers, radios, video calling, and more. Whilst at a principal stage, these interactions become silenced as the nations black out, Louise's private communication with China's General Shang is arguably the film's most important and defining moment. Once she has learned the gift of the heptapod language, the ability to see the future, not just your own, but the planet's, she makes the treasonous call to the country which is preparing to destroy their spacecraft. She details an extremely poignant and personal moment of Shang's forthcoming story, which forces him to call an emergency press conference and stop the attack. We discover what Louise communicated to Shang in an entirely separate sequence, sometime in the near future at a glamorous World Organization meeting. Here Villeneuve is showing the ways in which our actions are often influenced by what we hear and see, and that our emotional connections we treasure communicate as fluently as language. Villeneuve's latest is an intensely potent and distinctly human film. It delicately builds the idea of connection and communication throughout, and in the final 15 minutes, when you gain the truest sense of clarity, you realise you've been witnessing something quite frankly remarkable. Arrival is evocative and soulful cinema, which is teeming with intrigue. It grants no easy solutions to the many questions it poses, but is all the richer and more meaningful for it. The language of life are the very veins to this otherworldly occupant, and the blood surging through them speaks volumes about us earthbound.